Hello, and welcome to Lunch and Learn with Vernon Park Church of God. We are so glad to have you here today, and we thank you once again for watching us. I am Pastor Bruce McKinney. I serve as the Body Life Pastor of Vernon Park Church of God. And I want to thank our senior pastor for this opportunity, Pastor Gerald January, to be before you and to come before you with this lesson. So let's get into the lesson. This is, of course, part three of the book of Ephesians, and we are in chapter two. And so I encourage you to get your Bibles, turn to the book of Ephesians, and we're going to start in chapter two. And while you're doing that, let me just give you a little review of the background of the book of Ephesians. The book of Ephesians, the author is the Apostle Paul, and the time frame is that the book was written is A.D. 61, and the place is from Rome. Paul was in prison at the time. He was under house arrest, but he wanted to encourage the churches throughout throughout the various regions. So the region of the city of Ephesians was one of those churches. And the theme of the book of Ephesians is the church, the body of Christ. So let's get into this study. We don't have a whole lot of time, and so we're going to do what we call a Bible bite, and we're going to get a little bit of this lesson starting chapter 2, verse 4. So let's take a look at that. And it reads like this. It says, "But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved." So let's just take a look at this verse a little bit. Look at the 3 points in it that it talks about. First of all, it talks about God's love for us and is great. And look at how it starts. It says, because of his great love for us. It is because of love that God took the action that he did. And so we look at this, and God's love is so great. How great is his love? The Bible tells us in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." So we know that God's love is great. We also know that God is rich in mercy. Now, we have spoken in past lessons about grace. And grace, of course, is receiving something beneficial that you did not deserve and could not have earned. But mercy is something totally different. Mercy is withholding punishment that we justly deserve or should have been given. So God withheld the punishment. What was the punishment that God withheld from us? The Bible talks about that the wages of sin is death. Our sin earned us death. That is the punishment that God withheld from us. And how did he do that? Through the blood of Jesus Christ. The fact that Jesus died on the cross and paid for our penalty of death and sin. He paid that penalty with his blood. And then it says, God talks about God has made us alive. And in the fifth verse, it says, made us alive with grace, even when we were dead in transgressions. Look at that. God made us alive. How did he make us alive? Because he gave us life through Jesus. He gave us life through Jesus. We were dead in our transgressions. We was dead in sin. We were part of the walking dead, so to speak, because sin, the only path that sin has, the only conclusion that it has, is death. But God delivered us from that through the blood of Jesus Christ. So let's continue on in this second chapter. And so we're going to look at verse 8. And this is a powerful verse. Verses 8 and 9 are really awesome. So look at them. It says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. Now, look at this. For it is by grace. There's that word again, grace, receiving a benefit that you did not deserve and one that we could not have earned. So it is by grace we have been saved through faith. Look at that, through faith. There is a simple formula for salvation. The first thing is God's grace. That is the first part of this formula, totally by God's grace, through faith. You have to believe it. You have to believe it. There are some people who just don't believe anything, no matter what you tell them, good or bad, they don't believe it. Some people, they're always talking about the bad things and things like that. But if someone says they have a gift for you and all you have to do is come and get it or open the door and you will receive it or something like that, unless you believe it, I don't want you opening doors for strangers or anything like that, but as long as you don't claim that gift or don't believe that you have that gift, you'll never receive it. And that's the way it is with salvation. The salvation is there by the grace of God, but until people believe it, accept it by faith, they will never receive it. And look at this. This is not by works. It is not by works. And the Bible talks about not by works so that no one can boast. Do you know if people could work for this, they would talk about how they earned their salvation? You know, they would say, you know, I'm a scholar. I'm a doctor in salvation. I have my master's in salvation. Let me make this clear. There's nothing wrong with those degrees, but you can't earn those in salvation. That will not get you salvation. It is not by works. It is a gift. It is a gift of God. He simply gave it to us by grace because we believed in Jesus Christ. He gave it to us. And this way, everyone is on the same level ground. No one can boast about what they did to give salvation. You cannot pay money to get it. You cannot do works to get it. You cannot have connections to get it. There is no politics in salvation. Aren't you glad about that? And look, and then let's keep moving on here. So we are going to look at verse 13. Let's just take a look at that verse. It says, but now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. So look at this. We were far away from God. What made us be far away from God? What separated us from God? Come on, I know you know the answer. Keep thinking. Sin, exactly. Sin. Sin separated us from God. How can a sinful man come close to a holy God? There is no way. There is no way. But we were far away from God. So what brought us near? Let me give you this brief example that may help you understand this. Let's say for some reason you really liked me and you loaned me, I don't know, let's pick a figure. You loaned me $1 million. Why? I don't know. It's just part of the example. But you loan me $1 million and I say, okay, I'm going to pay you back. But I have a job and I want don't let this get out because it's not true. It's just an example. Let's say I have a job that only pays me $5 an hour. And with that job, there is no possible way that I can pay back that $1 million. So what happens when the time comes for me to pay that $1 million? You're looking for your $1 million to be paid back. I can't pay it. So now we have a separation. I want to avoid you because I can't pay it, and you want to find me to either get that $1 million or to put some kind of punishment on me. That's how it was with us and God. We had a debt to God that we could not have paid, could not have possibly paid, but we owed him so much. So a benefactor comes along and says to you, I know that Pastor Bruce owes you $1 million, and I know he only earns $5 an hour. And again, I just say this is an example. And so I'm going to pay that $1 million. So now my debt to you has been paid, and we have been reconciled. And that's what Jesus did for us. He paid that debt that we could not possibly have paid, and we are reconciled. We're drawn near to God by the blood that Jesus Christ shed on Calvary. I don't know about you, but that is something. That is a wonderful thing that makes me just rejoice and know that our salvation is secure because of what Jesus has done. So let's move on. We have a few minutes left here. So let's look at we're going to look at the end portion of verse 20, and then we're going to look at 21 and verse 22. The end portion of 20 ends with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. Look at this. Jesus is the chief cornerstone of what? Of the church. He is the builder. He is the foundation of the church. So let's continue to read. It says, in him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. Now, notice this. There's some things that you should know about the church. First of all, the church is not a building. We have church in a building. Not now, but we do have church in a building. But the church is not a building. No matter how pretty it is, how large it is, how small it may be, the church is not a building. The church is built on Christ, not on any human being. Now, we have a lot of good, faithful servants in the church. They do what God has called them to do, and they serve others. They love God, they serve God, and they serve others. And that is great, and that is what we do here at Vernon Park. But the fact of the matter is, the church is built on Christ. It is built on the love that God has shown us through Christ. It's built on the works of Christ. So then the other thing we need to understand, let me get back to this building thing, just as a brief example. This building thing, when we moved to Linwood, we could not have church in the building because it was not completed on the inside. We had church for about 4 months in a large tent. Did the service change? No, the service was high. It was wonderful. It was awesome. Why? Because the church was built on Christ. And not only that, but the church is in you because the people of the church, those that have been called, the called out, the redeemed of the Lord, were there. We were worshiping God. That's what made the church. That is what the church is. You have to remember that sometimes we say, we want people to come to church. We want to invite them to church. You are the church. We are the church. And yes, we want them to come to hear the word of the Lord being taught by the senior pastor or the preacher of that day. And that is wonderful. But one thing about it, if you want people to see the church, when they see you, they should see the church. Let's say amen to that. So that concludes our time for today. This is this is a Bible bite. It's a lunch and learn. So while you're eating your sandwiches, you can get a bite of the Word of God. And for those of you who do not know Jesus Christ in the pardon of your sins, I invite you to accept salvation today. And you can do this very simply. All you have to do is just say, Lord, I accept you as my Savior. I believe that you died for my sin. Forgive me of my sins. I want you to be the head of my life. Lead my life, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. And if you said that prayer or one similar to it, then, and meant it, then I want to welcome you into the family of God. And I encourage you today to reach out to us, go to bpcog.org, and let us know that you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior. And I want to thank you for your support. I want to thank those that have been given throughout and encourage those who want to give to do so. There are three ways that you can give. You can give through PayPal, go to bpcog.org, and you can give through PayPal. You can mail in your donation to Vernon Park Church of God, P.O. Box 754 in Glenwood, Illinois, 60425. Or you can go through Tithe.ly. You can text to give at 844-985-1891. I know I went through that information pretty quick, but all you have to do is visit us on vpcog.org. And once again, I want to thank you so very much for watching us today. And may God bless you and your family, and be safe.